formed in the way that you would expect from somebody who was shaped in the period of the minstrel show. He thought of himself as an entertainer, not as an artist. I'm sure somewhere in here he knew he was an artist. But his goal was to give simple, uncomplicated pleasure to people. And when jazz musicians after World War II started to think of themselves in a more self-conscious way as artists, and especially when black musicians began to become concerned with the idea of presenting themselves with what they regarded as racial dignity, they were made very uncomfortable by Armstrong's laughing, smiling platform demeanor. And some of them foolishly went so far as to call him an Uncle Tom. He was nothing of the kind, and mostly they lived long enough to realize that he wasn't. I think in the case of Dizzy Gillespie, who was probably the most prominent of his critics, and the one who changed his own tune about Armstrong at the end of his life, it was more than anything else a matter of the son wanting to murder the father, you know, that classic paradigm.
Uh-huh. So it was Oedipal.
Yes, yeah. I think so. And Armstrong, he took these things in stride. He didn't like them. No black man, especially a black man of great dignity and self-awareness and accomplishment like Armstrong, wanted to hear himself called an Uncle Tom. But I think Armstrong knew that the best possible answer to that was to play, to make his art.
Well, speaking of playing, I wonder if you'd read a short passage from your book. This is just a paragraph in which you describe the reaction to a 1929 performance of When You're Smiling,
yes,
by Armstrong.
Yes. Just to let people know what the context is, Armstrong was the first jazz trumpeter to play very fluently in the highest registers of the instrument. And this describes an episode when a bunch of musicians got to hear him do that in person for the first time. The bandstand was surrounded by musicians, some of whom suspected that Armstrong was playing a trick instrument on which he could play higher than normal. One of them asked to see his trumpet between sets. Taft Jordan recalled, "So the guy put his mouthpiece in and sounded C on Pop's horn and C on his own. He ran the scale on his and he ran the scale on Pop's. It was all the same. It was no trick horn. It was just the man, the difference of the man."
Great. Yeah, I think that encapsulates so much about Armstrong that you get across in that book. You've also written, and this is your latest book, but you've also written two opera librettos.
Yes, I've written one and had it produced, and another will be premiered in April.
Actually, in Philadelphia.
Yes, in Philadelphia, in 2011.
April 2011.
Yes.
It sounds very interesting. It's a comedy about the making of Stravinsky's Rite of Spring.
It's a backstage comedy, yes, that's right.
Fabulous idea.
It's called Danse Russe. Central City Opera will be performing it. And Paul Moravec, who won the Pulitzer Prize a few years ago, is the composer. We also worked together on our first opera, The Letter, which was premiered last year by Santa Fe Opera.
And that was based on the Somerset Maugham story.
Right, which was famously filmed in Hollywood with Bette Davis.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely the most thrilling experience of my life was to write a libretto and have it produced and take a curtain call in front of 4,000 screaming people.
Well, we've had another librettist here. We had Gene Shear as a guest, and he described the same feeling at the Met for the American Tragedy. And he also talked about some of the challenges of writing with a composer. And I wonder if you'd talk a little bit about that, coordinating your words with
right.
someone else's music.
Well, Paul and I are old friends. That makes a difference. And I am myself a musician, which most librettists aren't. And that makes a very big difference. But when we first set out to write an opera, I knew a lot about the history of opera. And I knew where composers and librettists occasionally had trouble. And I realized that a libretto is not an independent work of art. It is an enabling condition that, if you're lucky, allows the composer to write great music. And so at every point in the collaboration, I realized that if it didn't work for Paul, it wasn't going to work. So I had to be constantly aware of that, just as I had to be aware that every word I wrote would be sung, and that changes the whole effect. So we worked together very closely. We lived two blocks apart in New York. We would have face-to-face sessions, something that I think is not common in opera collaborations. And we truly worked as collaborators. And I can say with some pride that we never had a single argument. We had some discussions. But I had said to myself at the beginning, if I cannot persuade Paul that what I want to do makes sense, I will do what he wants. Well, it never came to that. We were on the same page all the way through.
I see. So do you think some of that comes from having been in a, well, played music with a group, and perhaps even playing jazz, and the kind of improvisation and adjustment that comes with that, I would think, is something similar to what you're describing.
It's funny, I never thought of it that way before, but jazz is, after all, the ultimate collaborative art form.
Right.
You come together on the stand, and the performance happens before your eyes. And if you're not willing to bend, to go with the people that you're with, and I was a bass player, so I was playing in support, you know, I was not the front man. Mm. If you can't go with them, they're not going to go with you. So perhaps it did make a difference in that respect. I had never done that kind of collaboration as a writer, and I found, to my amazement, that I loved it. Not just the collaboration with Paul, but the whole collaborative aspect of getting a work on stage.
Mm-hmm.
It was, as I say, it was a great thrill. I learned more from producing The Letter than from any artistic experience I've ever had. And I can't wait to do it again.
And I look forward to seeing it here in Philly. You're also a blogger. I mean, you're very, very eclectic and very wide-ranging in your writerly interests. The site is About Last Night, and obviously you are then connected with the new media landscape, so to speak.
I was the first reasonably well-known arts writer, somebody with a national audience, to start a blog about the arts.
Can you give us your thoughts about blogging, about the internet, about the new move away from print media that seems to be occurring?
And I think blogging is the most important thing to happen to arts journalism in my lifetime, because it empowers the serious amateur to play on the same playing field as me. And I assure you, this country is full of people who have valuable and compelling and exciting things to say about the arts who aren't writing for magazines and newspapers. I spend at least as much time reading arts blogs as I do any kind of paper publication. Essentially, what blogging has done is lower the cost of the printing press to zero to make it possible for anybody to get into the game and be noticed. And, well, I think that for me, and I've been blogging now for, I guess, 7 or 8 years.
Hmm.
For me, it has been immensely, immensely stimulating to be able to react immediately, to try out ideas. I think of the blog as a kind of public notebook. When Paul and I were working on our opera, I blogged regularly about its progress. My books, I always let people know what's going on with them. Sometimes I publish early drafts.
Hmm.
I just think of the blog as an opportunity to share with people what happens in my workshop.
And yet you're also a print journalist, so you must see that there is a shift now happening in which print journalism seems to be languishing. And I guess I'll ask you the question from another direction, because you've written about H.L. Mencken, the great journalist and critic. What do you think he would say about the current media landscape?
Well, probably the same thing he said about the media landscape in the 20s.
Which was not very flattering.
A man of fathomless cynicism when it came to just about everything, including his colleagues. But I think he would have been interested in the new media, in blogging, precisely because it eliminates the barriers that allow people, that prevent people from publishing exactly what they think at any given moment. He might have been tempted by that, although he had no difficulty getting published other than during World War II. He would have wanted to be paid, and that, of course, is the great problem with the new media, is that you don't get paid to do it.
Mm.
I see blogging as a way of publicizing my print media activities. It interacts with them. It increases the audience. It's a way that I market my books. It stimulates me. It's interesting in its own right. I write things for my blog that I would never try to write for print media, usually not because they're controversial in some way, but because the writing approach is different. They're more freeform. They're link heavy. I might write something for the blog that arises from a YouTube clip, for example, which you really can't do very well in a newspaper because people can't see what you're talking about.
Right.
But to me, it's all one large process, some of which I get paid for, some of which I don't. But for me, my writing life is, first of all, I have to pay the rent. And after that, I want not to be bored. And I have tried to structure my life in such a way as to avoid boredom.
We are out of time, but I do want to note something. It's interesting that you mentioned the cynicism of Mencken. And I would say, the lack of cynicism in Armstrong.
Armstrong was an utterly uncynical man.
But I'm thinking about you, and I have to say this is the only time I've met you and spoke to you. It strikes me that you are not a cynical person.
Cynical at all.
So you fall more on the Armstrong side.
I worked on the editorial page of a newspaper for a number of years. I'm cynical about politicians, but I'm not cynical about life. And the joy of writing a book about Louis Armstrong was the joy of spending several years with somebody who was totally, refreshingly uncynical and took life as it came. He was a lot of fun to be with, and I hope to read about.
Well, I want to thank you very much, Terry Teachout, for being here today and speaking to us about so many things.
For me as well.
And thank you for joining us today at the Drexel Interview.